Of all the people, no one in my judgment, and sitting with 21, 22 years of hindsight behind us, forgetting how difficult it was just to be fair in the South about civil rights, that anyone in my judgment stood out, stands out more as a symbol of what the South has become than Roy Collins.
In 1954, I was playing football for Florida State University. I was also sitting on the bench a lot, too. But that was the first encounter I had with the Governor Leroy Collins. And he was everything that I thought politics should be. And what I don't think it is now. He had grace and dignity and truth, and I think he's a very special man, and I'm proud to say that I know him and that he's my friend.
Collins was born in Tallahassee on March 10, 1909. He is known to his friends simply as Roy, a man of vision, and a man with more than enough courage, good humor, and intellect to see those visions through. The kind of leader Sam Walter Foss had in mind when he wrote, "Bring me men to match my mountains. Bring me men to match my plains. Men with empires in their purpose and new eras in their brains." High school and law school honor graduate, lawyer, state senator and representative, naval officer, Florida's 33rd governor, chairman of both the Southern Governors Conference and the National Governors Conference, president of the National Association of Broadcasters, United States Community Relations Director, author, United States Undersecretary of Commerce, countless citations and honorary degrees including Phi Beta Kappa, and the list goes on and on and on.
We sometimes refer to this as Governor's Row. These are all former governors of the state of Florida: Charlie Johns, Ferris Bryant, Clyde Kirk, and over here we have Hayden Burns and Leroy Collins. Governor Collins was the first governor to be elected for consecutive terms. He was the first American governor to serve simultaneously as the chairman of the Southern Governors Conference and the National Governors Conference. Governor and Mrs. Collins, the former Mary Call Darby, raised their four children in this majestic home on the north end of Adams Street here in Tallahassee. It was built by Mrs. Collins' great-grandfather, who was twice territorial governor. One of the most historic buildings in the state of Florida, it is known as the Grove.
Jane, do you have my hairbrush? Oh, Mama, this dress just doesn't look right.
Politics and politics, politics and politics.
That it shall ever be said of our administration, they did not have the vision to see, or seeing that they did not have the will to try.
Very exciting times for me and for my family and for our many friends from all over the state who had really made it possible to realize that I was actually governor was difficult to comprehend. But when the inauguration came and we were actually there in office, it was quite a shock to realize that now the main event was here and all the preliminaries were over.
But how did this man of the people, this tenacious leader who insisted on integrity above all else, get his roots and wings? Roy's father, Marvin Sr., was a retail grocer who moved to Tallahassee from Tampa when he married the future governor's mother, the former Mattie Brandon, who was an adventurous school teacher from Thomasville, Georgia. The Collinses taught their children, four boys and two girls, the love of family and the importance of hard work and sound principles, lessons they had learned well from their own parents. Roy still relishes the memory of those hard-working grandparents.
I learned a lot of lessons from that man that I shall never forget. I guess the one that stands in memory the most clearly had to do when we were working in the fields pulling corn that had been planted with velvet beans.
And the big bean pods were covered with a fuzz that our sweat-covered heads and hands and bodies all picked up like a magnet. The heat, the fuzz, and the continual bending and pulling had me itching and hurting all over, and so tired that I felt I surely would go out with a heat stroke at any minute.
And we would get near the end of a row and feel like that we could not survive much beyond more row, just one more row.
There will be times when your body will ache and your mind will become so tired that you feel you cannot continue to be rational in your thinking and that you cannot go any further. But still you know that you too must make one more row. And then you can be satisfied that you have done your total best. And believe me, I have found, and you too may find, that this extra drive has made the difference between failure and success. One more row. Thank you.
I love this spot. My grandfather Collins came to this part of Florida as a Methodist circuit rider preacher. He preached regularly here at Pisgah Church and at three other churches in this area. He died in one of these other churches, the one over at Havana, while he was preaching a sermon when he was still in his 50s. Every time I visit an old country church, I like to see the cemetery. I'm reminded every time of those beautiful words of Gray in his elegy in the country churchyard. Full many a gem of purest race serene, the dark unfathomed caves of ocean bare, many a flower is born to blush unseen and waste its sweetness on the desert air.
Well, Roy and I grew up together in a family of six children. He was just old enough for me to really look up to as a big brother. I was the baby, and he was real good about letting me tag along with him. And that relationship has lasted. We like to do the same things. As I said, he was a good student and helped me in my studies, and then we played in the band together. And then when I was married, I was the only one who moved away from Tallahassee.
A band member, a regular church attendant, a grocery store clerk, a considerate brother, a good student, all part of the busy childhood of Roy Collins. In addition to younger sister Sue, the Collins children included the oldest brother Brandon and youngest brother Arthur, both deceased. The oldest sister, Alice, helped their mother look after the other five children.
Our parents got us off to Sunday school and church at Old Trinity Methodist just as regularly as the weeks rolled around. I can still see that row of eight pairs of shoes on our back porch, all polished to a perfect shine. But mornings were not enough. On Sunday afternoons, Mother watched the clock again to be sure that we children were at the church by 4 o'clock for Epworth League. That's what Trinity's youth program was called in those days, and that's where Roy got his first experience in speaking before an audience.
When the time came to consider higher education, Roy and his older brother Marvin, along with friend John Humphreys, decided to head north.
We left Tallahassee by train, went to Jacksonville, where we caught a Clyde Line ship, and went to New York.
Vassar College is located there in Poughkeepsie, New York. And at that time, it was an all-girls school. And they had a very strong dramatic department and produced plays from time to time. They ran short of male characters, and so they recruited some boys from around town to take parts in some of those plays. And I got a call and an opportunity to participate in one of those plays. And this led to other plays that followed. And it gave me an opportunity really to come to know a great many of those Vassar girls and to have a lot of fun practicing with them and producing plays with them. In fact, there's been some speculation as to whether or not I got as much education from Eastman College at the time as I got from the Vassar girls.
But we got through with that course in less than a year's time and came back to Tallahassee. I finished before they did, came back. Roy and John, they bought a Model T Ford for about $20 and they drove it to Tallahassee. And they named it the Spirit of the South. They had it painted on both sides of the car and they were very proud of it. They arrived home on Christmas morning.
The friendship between Roy and John has continued through the years. They are now involved in a business partnership and like nothing better than getting together for a hike through a stretch of beautiful Florida woodland. After Poughkeepsie, the next 2 years found young Roy Collins utilizing his business training as a wholesale grocery shipping clerk and then as a bank teller. But the future governor was restless and responded favorably to the advice that his next step should be law school.
I knew real well Judge Glenn Terrell in Tallahassee and also Mr. Fred Davis, who is a practicing attorney here. Both said I should go to Cumberland. And so I got my father to match $500, which I had saved, and I went to Cumberland and enrolled in the law school there. I graduated with an LLB degree and came home to take the bar examination and hopefully to start my practice in January of 1931, right in the depths of the Depression.
Before leaving Cumberland University, Roy passed both the Tennessee and Arkansas bar exams and came home to score one of the highest grades ever recorded on the difficult Florida examination. Roy Collins was now a struggling young Tallahassee attorney. Her name was Mary Call Darby, a lovely Tallahassee girl whose great-grandfather had been territorial governor Richard Keith Call. Roy had known her casually since high school, but now in 1932, they had, in Roy's words, weeded out other interests. Despite the fact the Depression was upon the land and his law practice income was often less than $90 per month, the question was love and the answer was marriage.
But marriage seemed totally unrealistic because of my limited resources. And with the help of a part-time WPA indexing job, my income began to climb. So we were married June 29th, 1932, in St. John's Church. It was just a piece in the paper that at 10 o'clock a.m. we would be married and anybody who wanted to come would be welcome. Well, the church was full, the bride was beautiful, and the groom had $100 and a borrowed Chevrolet to make a honeymoon trip to Savannah, Georgia.
It is now 1934. The decision is made to run for the Florida House of Representatives. The victory over three older campaigners was overwhelming. He was reelected in both 1936 and 1938. Roy Collins was no longer a political novice. In 1940, he was elected to the state Senate, and in 1942, he was reelected without opposition. Along came World War II, and Roy resigned from the Senate to serve as a lieutenant in the Navy. Before returning home, he was again nominated and elected to the Senate without opposition, serving continuously until 1954, a total of 18 years in the state legislature.
I guess the highlight of Roy Collins' career in the legislature came in 1947, when he served as chairman of the Senate Education Committee and led the fight for what we know as the Minimum Foundation Program. What it said basically was that the state had a responsibility to make sure that every student, every child, no matter where he or she lived, had an equal opportunity for a good education, and the state ought to put up the money to do it. It was a major dramatic change in the philosophy of education in this country, and Roy Collins got it passed through the legislature with only one vote against it. In addition, that bill did other things. It equalized black and white teacher salaries. Now, in 1981, today that may not sound like a big thing, but in 1947, to pass a bill which said that black teachers and white teachers got the same salary was a major achievement, and Roy Collins did that.
Roy Collins must now make the single most important decision of his life. His good friend, Governor Dan McCarty, had died in office. Should he seek the post?
Now, I'd lived in Tallahassee all my life, and governors came and went. I'd served in the legislature for 20 years, and I'd gotten to know many governors very, very well, some fine ones and some not so fine. And I'd always sort of indulged the idea that maybe, just maybe, someday I could become governor. And of course, when we got into the campaign, I really felt like we could win and should win.
It was a big challenge, but he ran. And he won. As one friend put it, you could feel good about a vote for Roy Collins. Sincerity, integrity, competence, and determination flowed from him like water from a spring.
I think one of the significant things about Leroy Collins' first campaign in 1955 was that it set the tone for the entire ensuing 6 years of his administration. He promised the people good government. They believed him, as a result of which, he had an almost entire voluntary group of campaign workers, both at the state and local level. And although he was running against two very formidable opponents, he was able to win by a considerable margin. In his second campaign, although it would have been much easier for him and much more political for him to have followed the line that some governors were, southern governors particularly, were following in those days and had taken an extreme position with respect to the civil rights, but he had told the people that the schools were not going to be closed, that the law would be followed, and there would be order. And as a consequence, he won over five opponents by a very large majority in the first primary.
When he was in the office, he made himself available to the press always and to as many visitors as he could see in one day. We transcribed his weekly press conferences and furnished printed copies to all of the publishers over the state. And it seemed to bring him closer to the people by so doing, I think, the way he made himself available to so many people in such a short period of time.
Leroy Collins was really our first governor in the television age. His use of TV back in the 1954 campaign, I think, propelled him directly into the governor's chair. And in subsequent years, he sat before the cameras and he reassured us, he reasoned with us, and he brought us through some difficult times. Times, for example, when we had desegregation. He was a leader in every sense of the word, and an inspiration to all of us.
As legislative aide to Governor Collins during the 1955-1957 sessions of the legislature, I had the opportunity to witness firsthand Roy's plans and programs for the state of Florida. First of all, lawyers would draft the legislation, and then once the legislation was introduced, they would come to Tallahassee and help get that legislation passed. Some of the legislation that became immediately involved in was the Turnpike Authority. While we take that naturally today, in those days it was difficult for the tourists to get to the southern part of the state. With the Turnpike Authority, this enabled them to get there in a hurry, and they were paying for the cost of it. Another program that was dear to Roy's heart was the field of education. The legislation that was produced from the 1955 session was a creation of not only an urban institution at the University of South Florida, but community colleges, which were spread throughout the state, which would allow the people to be able to commute and get their higher education.
I put together a very strong team of people devoted to the public interest to help me establish policies for the state's future and to give management leadership and direction in the implementation of those policies.
Roy Collins had an almost evangelical zeal for attracting into public service with him
those he respected. And he would use any ethical strategy, relentless pursuit, and his incomparable talent of persuasion to get those he respected to join him. I know of many instances in which he attracted highly qualified citizens to leave their personal life and enter public service at great personal sacrifice. He did this with me when he offered me an appointment to the Supreme Court. When I refused, he came to Fort Lauderdale and spent an evening with my wife and me. And when I still refused, he then enlisted the aid and assistance of my wife, and together they convinced me that I should do this. I'm very glad that I did. He's the kind of a person who's always looked up to his God, but never down on any human being.
Governor Collins has been my personal friend for more than 30 years. He is a very enthusiastic football fan and knowledgeable of the game. He used to attend my games, and at times he was the only public official who was there. He diagrammed a play, an outside play that he wanted my fastbacks to use. I called it the Leroy play. And you can bet your bottom dollar that my boys had pride in making that play go. I have seen him grow from a senator in the state to governor of the state of Florida to high administrative positions in federal government. And through it all, he has shown his leadership. I like to think that I had something to do with his persuading him to run for governor in 1955. Civil rights legislation had just passed in 1954, and we needed strong leadership in Florida. He had to campaign during an atmosphere of high tension and racial discord. He unified the state of Florida. He administered desegregation. He integrated the schools. He was a man for the job.
Looking back over my life, there's absolutely no question but that the most rewarding, the most satisfying, the most challenging experiences of my life were in serving as governor of the state of Florida. And so I often say to people, especially school children, that there is no other job that can compare with being governor. No other job.
Roy Collins, governor. Happy times. Not so happy times.
And we ought not be sending any word out over this nation that we've been wallowing in the mire down here with a poor, inadequate school system, because that's not the fact.
Family time.
While we're all here together, the whole Collins family would like to wish to all of the people of Florida in every section of our state a merry, a happy, and a safe Christmas. Well, actually, we have some special reasons for this to be a happy Christmas here. Because suppose you tell them about that.
Well, we're so glad to have Roy and Jane with us this Christmas. We feel very thankful, and it will be a wonderful and a meaningful Christmas for all us. I hope that all of you have your families together. We certainly wish you a wonderful Christmas.
Yes, and while we are thinking about families and about things personal to us, let us not forget, Darby, that at the time of the birth of Jesus, the theme song of the angels was peace on earth and goodwill toward men. And there never has been a time, in our lifetimes at least, when it was more important that people think along those same lines. So let us all dedicate our efforts and our prayers and our hopes this Christmas time to peace on earth and goodwill toward men.
The program's achievements and charisma of Roy Collins had garnered much national attention and support. In the last year of his gubernatorial administration, he was named permanent chairman of the Democratic National Convention held in Los Angeles and was considered by many as a possible vice presidential candidate, a move he discouraged.
Tallahassee and indeed all of Florida have every reason to be proud of the job Governor Leroy Collins did as permanent chairman of the Democratic National Convention in Los Angeles in 1960.
I went out as his secretary and arrived about a week ahead in order to requisition supplies and set up the office. From the moment Governor Collins arrived in town, he was a real star. He had been receiving a lot of national publicity from the moment he'd been appointed permanent chairman, and Los Angeles was really looking forward to having him come. The governor was on camera about 12 hours a day throughout the convention, which started at noon and ran until about midnight every night.
Amid the hoopla of the convention, there was at least one embarrassing moment for Mary Cole Collins. Embarrassing then, but quite humorous in retrospect.
I very much wanted the children to hear Roy's opening speech as permanent chairman of the convention, and I not only wanted them to hear him, I wanted them to have to remember seeing him making the speech. So the night before, we had had very good seats, but unfortunately they were behind the pyramid for the television cameras. So as the identical seats across the aisle had been vacant, I asked if it would be all right for us to move over, which we did. I had all the children lined up, and we were listening very carefully to Roy's speech, which was quite good. And I heard a little stir in the audience. I wasn't sure what it was, but I wanted to hear the speech, and I rather resented the little sound that was made and continued to listen. And all of a sudden, there was an unusual stillness near us. And I still watched the stage when suddenly I realized that there was someone standing right by the seat. I looked up, and to my horror, I saw Eleanor Roosevelt with Adlai Stevenson, and I realized we were in her seats. I quickly gathered the children and took them back across the aisle.
Never one to rest on his laurels, Roy Collins served the next 3 years, 1960 to 1963, as president of the NAB, the National Association of Broadcasters.
We cannot have creativity in this medium without at the same time being controversial. And I think that if the American people should ever demand of the broadcaster that he not be controversial, at the same time they are inhibiting him from being creative. And I think that could be a very serious problem.
It was a demanding job, full of challenge, full of rewards, full of stress.
It was indeed a very stressful time for Governor Collins, because it was a stressful and turbulent time in the history of radio and television when he assumed the leadership of the NAB. There was a great public debate on the role and contributions of this new communications force in our society. And Governor Collins elevated the debate by his strong convictions. His strong idealism really came into conflict with the commercial interests that have to exist in the broadcasting industry. For example, he was an advocate of improved quality programming at a time when the chairman of the FCC was making broadcasters nervous by calling television a vast wasteland. The governor felt that the radio and television codes should be amended to control cigarette advertising because of the burning health issue that was involved. The fact of the matter is, had Governor Collins' leadership been heeded, the Congress probably would not have taken the drastic action, which they subsequently did take, to outlaw all radio and television advertising of cigarettes, which is now the law of the land.
If the NAB presidency was difficult, Roy Collins' next position was well nigh impossible. Congress passed the Civil Rights Act, and President Johnson convinced Roy that he was needed as Director of Community Relations of the United States. The title sounded harmless enough, but it was 1964, and metropolitan areas across the nation, Los Angeles, Chicago, Cleveland, New York, were struggling with high tensions and dangers of riots and other public disorders. And Leroy Collins was cast in the role of conciliator. 1964. The fuses in Selma were already burning. Before Collins and his staff arrived in Alabama, There had already been a bloody confrontation between civil rights workers and law enforcement officials at Pettus Bridge. Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. and his followers had vowed they would cross the bridge and march to Montgomery. Police officials were just as adamant they would not cross. Roy Collins knew a compromise must be reached.
Dr. King was staying with a local dentist, and I felt that it was necessary that I get in touch with Dr. King and see if we could find some way to prevent him from proceeding to lead the march the next morning. He was under an injunctive order from the court not to do that. And so when I found him, I think it was around 1 to 2 o'clock in the morning, he told me very frankly that there was not any way he could stop it, that the people were there and they were going to march whether he was their leader or not, and he just had to do it. But I still insisted that we find some way to compromise, and he said, well, if you can find some kind of reasonable basis for that, go do it and let me know. But suppose, I insisted, that you are not resisted in your actual crossing of the bridge, would you be willing to stop there beyond the bridge at a line and not pass further, and then turn around and go back? Slowly, Dr. King realized that this would offer both sides a chance to win. He then asked, would we be allowed time to stand there and sing and pray and preach for 20 to 30 minutes? And I said, well, we'll try to work all this out. We just don't know whether we can do it or not, but we will get in touch with you later as quickly as we can. We left and found out as soon as possible who would be in charge on the governor's side across the bridge. It was after daylight that we were able to get to the command post and talk with the troop leaders. And then they had to call Montgomery. But finally, the word came that they would support the plan if the demonstrators would follow a route they would require to the bridge, and after crossing the bridge, stop short of a line they would clearly mark across the highway. They would be permitted to sing and pray and preach as requested. It was also agreed that I could be there. Well, this is what we wanted. And as fast as I could go, I carried this message to Dr. King. The march by that time was well underway. King said the route desired to the bridge presented no problem. I left telling him that our people would be right there, that if, when they crossed the bridge, anybody moved toward them, that we would grab them.
The next 2 years, 1965, 66, however quiet, were nonetheless productive. Roy Collins served these years as Undersecretary of Commerce of the United States. The Secretary, John Connor, had this to say about his number one assistant.
His ideals, his integrity, his innate ability to know instantly the right thing to do, have been a guide and inspiration to all of us who worked with him.
Someone has said that all great leaders temper the law with spiritual force. This is personified in Roy Collins. His great loves are God, family, and state. His 4 children and 11 grandchildren reside in Florida. It was here on Dog Island, in his small cottage overlooking the Gulf of Mexico, that he did much of the writing of his highly successful book, Forerunners Courageous.
I love this land, and I love to share its splendors with my children, grandchildren, and other friends who inhabit it. The island, the dunes, the weirdly contorted trees, all were formed by the lashing hurricanes of other centuries. And as a barrier island like this is made, so it can be washed away. Man has no way to prevent this from happening someday. Mild storms now from 1 year to the next take great quantities of the sand away from one part of the island and add it to another. Now our little house here has lasted now for 11 years, but the sea moves closer in each year, even when there are no violent storms. For me, a casual walk along our shoreline, watching the creatures of nature that inhabit it, the birds that patrol it, always searching for their food, is a restful adventure.
Leroy Collinses of this world don't rest. Roy continues to practice law in the Tallahassee firm of Irvin, Varn, Jacobs, Odom, and Kitchen. Bob Irvin is a charter member of his fan club.
Were I to complain at all about Roy Collins, it would be of his continued responses to an immense number of calls for public service. He worked as hard, with hours as long as any lawyer I know. More than half of this in unpaid public services. And I concede that I would like to see a greater part of his efforts devoted to our law practice and to solving our clients' legal problems. But I know that Roy Collins will follow the course he has charted for himself. That is, assist us to all worthy persons or causes who seek his help. He is a truly great American and a fine, fine lawyer and man.
The awards, honorary degrees, and requests for speeches continue to pour in. He's seen here in Dallas, Texas, receiving the prestigious Golden Plate Award presented by the American Academy of Achievement.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Perhaps I should commence my remarks with two prayers. One would be that the Lord would forgive the chairman for some of his slight exaggerations, and the other that he would forgive me for enjoying them so much. Members of the Academy, I'll forget.
For some men, those guided perhaps by divine favor, the accomplishments never seem to stop. Their story never ends, just makes a new start in a different direction. Even as this film is completed, the fall of 1981, Roy Collins continues to pursue countless projects in the public interest. As a matter of fact, Governor, what would be the proper way to close out a documentation of the life and times of Thomas Leroy Collins? Governor?
The music of You're Alive continues on WTAL in Tallahassee. One of the favorite songs of Governor and Mrs. Roy Collins. My dreams are getting better all the time.
I'm often asked how I see Florida's future. Well, it is a jigsaw puzzle. It can become a picture of great beauty, but it must be put together. Some of the pieces are adequate protection of our remarkable resources of nature, water, clean air, wildlife, and soil. Government, too, must be clean and lean and meet our fundamental needs like public education and public health. These are needs that are essential elements for healthy minds and bodies and strong leadership. Private business must thrive and provide jobs for people. And finally, I would say that we must have spiritual strength and citizen pride. If as citizens we can bring all these pieces together, we can have a great state, not only for ourselves, but for all generations to come.